One of the most unusual aspects of the medieval Jewish experience, which in many ways was replicated right up until like the 18th century, was in Ashkenazic lands a really young age of marriage. According to the Talmud, a woman may not be married against her will, and that means she has to reach the age of majority, which is basically 12 years old. But, and that is in itself a ridiculously young age by 21st century standards, but not at all in the medieval period. It is associated, of course, with puberty and the possibility of starting a family and so on. But the there is a pronounced tendency that we seem to see in Ashkenazic lands in particular to marry girls off even younger than them, sometimes married to men who are not much older than they, in Islamic lands, sometimes quite a bit older than they. There's a lot of interesting scholarship on why this may have been the case. Part of the reason seems to be competition. Let us not forget that Ashkenazic lands in the High Middle Ages still had really small populations. We're talking about communities that might have had 40 families, 50 families, sometimes even less in some of the larger communities. And so seeking an appropriate marriage partner, and by appropriate, I'm talking about class and wealth and family background in general, you know, it can be a very challenging thing. And so the competition for spouses was so intense that the age of marriage tended to drop. And by the way, it tended to drop from the limited evidence we have, it tended to drop in the higher classes more than in the lower classes. This could be because the higher classes, you know, were more focused on the idea of finding a match of their same social class, with a desire to try and contain resources within the family. So rather than marrying a wealthy boy to a poor girl and then essentially dissipating the family wealth, marrying a wealthy boy to a wealthy girl meant that they, you know, can consolidate their wealth, keep it within the family. Whereas less wealthy families might have actually needed the work product of the young man and the young woman a little bit longer than they could to marry them off at a younger age. It's also important to note, however, that the actual marriage ceremony in Judaism technically consists of two distinct phases. The first is what we might call betrothal or engagement, which, as the Talmud puts it, is fully binding on both parties and is completely marriage, with the exception that they do not live together. And then sometime later, you would have the actual marriage ceremony, which is celebrated under the canopy and so on. In Talmudic times, there was a gap between those two ceremonies, which was usually attributed to things like the necessity of pulling together the dowry, which is a very expensive endeavor to provide a young woman with a dowry to be able to essentially set up her home, was a potentially crippling economic event for a family. On the husband's side was not at all the same thing. It was a much more moderate affair to give the so-called bride price, so it was not equivalent in terms. So the Talmud says that these two events were traditionally separated by time to allow families to accumulate the assets to be able to support the young couple. But there are other reasons as well that are adduced by historians. Fear of mortality, for example. Infant mortality is very high, child mortality very high in the Middle Ages, and a concern that, you know, if we don't get them married off now, who knows what's going to be later. So a desire to, you know, use the Yiddish term chaparein, to carpe diem, take advantage of the moment. But I also want to mention that ultimately, over the course of the Middle Ages and into the early modern period, those two events, the betrothal and the actual marriage, were collapsed, and they are now customarily celebrated one immediately after the other on the same day. Because given that the betrothal constitutes actual marriage itself, even though they're not able to live together, society was aware of so many tragic situations where you have these young individuals and, they're separated from their intended and they meet someone else and all kinds of things can happen that really are disastrous for the marriage. So it became, much more the practice to put these two acts together. Women, once they were married, and especially once they started menstruating, they would begin a very important area of Jewish law known as the laws of family purity. This is essentially a euphemism for a ritual that follows menstruation in which a woman would immerse in a ritual bath called a mikvah. We've talked about this in the past, how this is one of the most important elements of a Jewish community is the establishment of a formal ritual bath. It doesn't necessarily have to be a building, but the water cannot be drawn normally from a well or something like that. A river could be used under some certain circumstances, or the ocean, or rainwater can be collected in a cistern, things like that, spring water, but it can't simply be like a bathtub sort of thing. So the presence of mikvaot is very much associated with these early communities. Not to go into this in great detail, but this is a very ancient practice in which the husband and wife would separate from each other during the period of menstruation and a certain amount of time afterwards as well. And then once that is concluded, then the woman would go to the mikveh, ritually immerse, and then regular relations would resume as well. Very important element in Jewish family life as a whole, and but more than we can say in this context. Now, it's to return to a topic we looked at a little while ago on polygamy. As I mentioned earlier, the incidence of men marrying more than one wife began to fade in Christian lands for a whole host of reasons. Perhaps one of the most important, however, is the prevailing custom of the non-Jewish society. It is a well-known historical truism that the way in which the surrounding society behaves is ultimately the way in which the Jewish population living there will also behave. The Yiddish expression is something like "as es chriselt sich, es yiddelt sich," which is hard to translate exactly. It means something like "as one Christianizes, one Judaizes," when they essentially do the same thing. In Muslim countries, this was not the norm. Men could marry up to four wives, and so it was not at all uncommon for men to engage in polygamy, despite the ban of Rabbeinu Gershom, which seems to have been primarily directed at Ashkenazic Europe and into newly Christian Spain. Also related to this is a phenomenon that is known in the biblical period and in the medieval period, but again begins to fade, the institution of concubinage. Or the Hebrew term is a pilegesh. And basically, this is a kind of common law marriage in which a man and a woman agree to live together as husband and wife, but the woman lacks all of the protections of marriage, including a really important document called the ketubah, which is essentially a marriage contract that the husband delivers to the wife, promising a level of support during marriage, including, upkeep and standard of living and things like that. And more importantly, promising a financial compensation in the event that the marriage is dissolved. In other words, if he chooses to divorce her, then he will have to pay a very significant penalty as well. The concubines were not protected by this ketubah document, which leads one to wonder why a woman would enter into such a relationship. But that, again, beyond the scope of what we're talking about here. What we did have, however, which is kind of fascinating, is incidences, particularly for the first couple of hundred years of the High Middle Ages, where you had lots of men traveling from Ashkenazic lands into Muslim lands and sometimes taking second wives. And this would be bigamy vis-a-vis the ban of Rabbeinu Gershom. But, you know, sometimes they would say, well, you know, I'm living in Sephardic lands while I do my business. And so I'm not bound by the ban of Rabbeinu Gershom. Maimonides in particular took a very dim view of this practice and indicated that, you know, travelers who want to get married have to definitively prove that they are not already married somewhere else to avoid, you know, anyone trying to get around this sort of loophole. And a significant amount of the responsa literature that deals with these questions gives us a sense of how men who are engaged in essentially being traveling salesmen would behave, and their wives who would take them to court saying, hey, you know, you agreed literally in writing not to take a second wife, and here you go doing it in Tunisia or something like that, and I want my traditional compensation for your breach of contract. So that's a good example, I think, of how responsa literature will give us kind of like a sad, unfortunate incidents. What we don't really get, though, is like, how common was this? How typical was this? Are we only looking at, you know, a very limited amount of bad behavior, or is this just, you know, typical of a much more common type of activity? At any rate, these are the kind of things that animate much of the literature and give us some sense of the relative privileges of men and women in the society. Where it's especially relevant is in Spain, because the southern half of Spain, very heavy Islamic influence, and even as it's increasingly Christianized, you have a Jewish population there who are not necessarily content to go along with Christian requirements for monogamy and prefer to maintain, you know, multiple marriages. By the way, while we're at it, I was doing some research and I saw this amazing Jewish wedding ring. Apparently they would actually like own these for communities or for families, and they would be used for the ceremony itself. I think this is 14th century. What a phenomenal piece of art this is. It's at the Met. Here you can see the underside of it, and it has like these two hands clasped. Really gorgeous work from that period. Now, connected to that, of course, after marriage is, God willing, motherhood. And I don't want to go too in-depth into the history of motherhood and childhood in particular, because I don't know enough about it. It's a really fascinating area of research that I've just kind of scratched the surface of, and I don't know enough to talk about it. But perhaps we could talk for a second about the institution of second marriages, because one of the things that we see quite a bit of in the responsa literature is the disputes between half-siblings over inheritance that frequently refer to this kind of like bigamous second marriages that occur as a result of husbands traveling afar. We have to come back to that, by the way, when we talk about divorce law. Related to this is, what if a woman does not have a child and then her husband passes away? So this is a major distinction between the Ashkenazic world and the Sephardic world, primarily in the Muslim influence. According to the biblical precedent, if a man dies before his wife is able to conceive a child, then his brother is required to marry her. And when you read the context of this ritual, which is called yibum in Hebrew or levirate marriage in English, it is very clear from the context that the surviving brother is just basically doing the right thing. Given the environment where in the biblical period women rarely existed on their own unless they were in some kind of unfortunate situation, they typically lived within the shadow of their father or their husband or their adult sons. They were never kind of like abandoned to their own devices. So unless they were like a widow, that kind of thing. So Yibum was considered just the right thing to do. It's clear from the context there that if the surviving brother refuses to marry his sister-in-law, the wife of his divorced brother, then he has failed to live up to his responsibility and is deserving of communal disapproval. Nevertheless, the Talmud recognizes, as the Bible does, that there are times that a brother may not want to marry his sister-in-law. And so there's kind of like a default secondary ritual called chalitza, which refers to the removal of the shoe, kind of an interesting ritual in which if he says, I really don't want to marry my sister-in-law, then she removes a shoe from his foot, and there's like, again, the communal opprobrium and things like that. So here's the thing. Yibum is clearly favored as the ideal choice, but the Talmud already in the Babylonian period is going back and forth over, you know, how appropriate this is for every situation. When you get to the Ashkenazic world, it seems very clear that the rabbis want to essentially give preference to chalitza over yibum. That is, the default case is to refuse these second marriages. They should not take place. In the Sephardic world, this is not the case, and Jews living in Muslim environments frequently have husbands, brothers marrying their sister-in-law after their brothers pass away. But in Ashkenazic lands, the default setting becomes chalitza. It's interesting to note that Rashi, among others, and Rashi, by the way, as we discussed recently, seems to be really pro-woman for his time. A lot of fascinating things there that indicate how he's separate from a lot of the other thinkers of his generation. He even valorizes the woman's opinion with regards whether she wants to marry her brother-in-law, something which is debated in the Talmud and for the most part dismissed in those social circumstances. But Rashi, thinking in the heavily Christianized environment of Northern Europe, is saying, wait a second, you know, the wife may have a lot of problem marrying her husband, and he finds Talmudic precedent to give her the privilege of refusing chalitza, or refusing yibum and demanding chalitza instead. A lot of fascinating things to say here, but I really want to save some time for perhaps the most important element of the period, which is divorce. Divorce is an issue that continues to reverberate in Jewish society today, primarily because the biblical precedent for divorce gives the husband far more power than the wife does. As I mentioned earlier, Rabbeinu Gershom put in place a ban on divorcing a woman against her will, which definitely improved the relative power differential of men and women, but there's still a very significant gap between their levels of authority in how to dissolve a marriage. Basically, it goes like this. The husband has the right to initiate a divorce, which then goes through procedures like Rabbeinu Gershom's demand that a woman consent as well. A woman, technically speaking, cannot force her husband to divorce, however. She can appeal to the court, and the court has a variety of judicial tools at its disposal to try to coax and convince and even coerce the husband into giving the divorce document, which is known as a get. Hence the sign here, you see, get refusal is abuse. But it's not an unlimited authority. It's not like the rabbis can simply say, well, this is clearly not working and we don't care what the husband thinks, we grant you a divorce. They don't have a clear-cut authority to do so. And this represents a very difficult problem because the woman who cannot get remarried is called literally a chained woman, or an aguna in Hebrew. This problem, of course, persists to the present day, and in fact, it's much worse in the 21st century. in the medieval period, the primary cause for an aguna is not a husband refusing to give the get, which, you know, there's definitely a disincentive to doing so because he would have to pay her the monetary fee outlined in the ketubah to do so. Typically, what would happen in the medieval period is a traveling husband would go missing, and perhaps he was killed on the road by bandits, or maybe he decided to just simply leave France behind and adopt a new identity in Egypt or something like that. These cases are described in the responsa literature, and this left the woman in a very difficult situation because she cannot prove that she is a widow, allowing her to remarry. And she cannot prove that she is a divorcee because her husband has disappeared. In the modern era, we have this problem where men will use the granting of a get as leverage to, you know, coerce something out of the wife, like child custody or the payment of debts or, you know, the distribution of assets differently. It's a terrible situation, really. And there's modern approaches to it and solutions to it that have varying levels of effectiveness, but not for our discussion at this point. At any rate, this is a noted problem, though, even in the medieval period, even though it's much smaller than we see it today, it is something which exercises the minds of the rabbis engaged in responsa literature to quite a large degree, and we still are not done with this particular situation. I would love to speak more about this, but it takes us further afield from history and more into, you know, rabbinic legal thought than I'm comfortable discussing. So let us just conclude, though, by thinking a little bit about women and their contribution to the family economy. There's no question that women in the medieval world worked. They worked incredibly hard, both at domestic tasks and at revenue-bearing activities. We should recall that some of the most basic tasks that we take for granted today took an incredible amount of time in the medieval period. In fact, right up until the Industrial Age, women's work, basically domestic tasks, was huge and overwhelming. Here's a photograph of some medieval women who are spinning thread. You can see they have the distaff is sort of like a third arm to hold the raw material like flax or wool, and it's kind of stuck on a stick and then put into the cummerbund that they wear so they can it stays steady. And then with the other two hands, which are now free, they can slowly like peel apart the threads, and they use the spindle, which is at the hanging down towards the ground. And young women and older women would all be involved in this for hours and hours every day just to make thread. And then they've got to take that thread and they've got to make cloth. And out of the cloth, they've got to make clothing. And that's why so many people only had one pair of pants, because it took forever to make these things. There was a huge amount of women's energy. You didn't have mass-produced goods like you have today. So even if they're working at, you know, what is typically called women's work, the domestic activities of making clothing, preparing food, washing clothing, things like that, that's a huge amount of time and value added to the household to provide these basic necessities. That said, let us not forget what we discussed a little while ago, that the women, Jewish women, are much more literate than the surrounding society. They are certainly much more urban and most likely numerate as well. And so we frequently find women engaged in business activities. We especially see this in the Geniza, where women are involved in all kinds of business. And sometimes, you know, with tremendous success, like, for example, the remarkable Wusha the broker, who's described in the Geniza archives. And as a after her marriage is dissolved, she keeps her business running and defies communal standards to insist on having, you know, her way. She is repudiated by the synagogue for some unrelated activities, but she nevertheless, you know, supports the synagogue with massive donations on Yom Kippur and things like that. And some fascinating women who are like really significant businesswomen described in the Geniza. We also have significant evidence that they're involved in the same economic activities that men are, like we discussed when we looked at finance and trade and so on. Sometimes they suffer from similar kinds of depredations as well, like in this terrifying image from the 14th century that is described in the caption as people ransacking a Jewish woman's house. And it's very unusually graphic depiction. You know, they're stealing the very valuable clothes off the line and breaking into their cabinets and things like this. Jewish women were assisting their husbands in many aspects of trade and commerce, you know, selling and buying, and also engaged in the money lending and other financial activities as well. So women are definitely a very important component to the medieval family economics. And with that, I want to conclude this brief discussion of women in the medieval period. I hope you found it interesting. Thank you very much for watching.